Hi, it's Maija here, and I'm continuing to catch up with my recent receipts. So in this video, I'm going to talk about the books I read in May, how I did in my challenges, and what my TBR count is at. I had a really good reading month in May. I read a lot of books that I really enjoyed, and I did make some progress in my TBR pile. My TBR count at the start of the month was 70 books, and let's start with the reads. So in May, I read In the Forest of Forgetting by Theodora Goss, which is a speculative fiction short story collection, and it's an old physical book. I'm going to talk about my favorite stories in this. I liked The Belt, in which a shoemaker's daughter marries a rich man who has a strange request. And it's a darker story with a fairy tale feel that sort of reminded me of how I felt like when I read my very first Theodora Goss, which was this short story called Red as Blood and White as Bone. Goss is pretty much guaranteed to get me with a darker fairy tale story. I also like the stories that featured Miss Emily Gray, who is this sort of Mary Poppins-like character with a dollop of be careful what you wish for. So there were three stories featuring her. One was Miss Emily Gray, then there was Conrad and Lessons with Miss Gray. I liked the first two that I mentioned the best, and the third one was still pretty interesting because it was written in first person plural. And Lessons with Miss Gray also linked to another story in this collection, so there were a couple of these interlinked ones. There's a content warning I'd like to give for this collection, and that is terminal cancer. There were two stories that revolved around this. Those were Lily with Clouds and In the Forest of Forgetting, so the title story. But there were also a lot of stories that have characters mention that their mothers or spouses died of cancer. Short story collections always have such different stories that there are always some that I really enjoy and some that I don't care for, that don't do much for me. I gave this one 3.5 stars. And finishing In the Forest of Forgetting put my TBR count to 69 books. Then I read another Theodora Goss book in May, and that one was European Travel for the Monstrous Gentlewoman, and it was an owned ebook. And it's this historical gothic fantasy. I'd been meaning to get to it for a while because I love the first book, A Strange Case of the Alchemist's Daughter. So this series mixes together characters from a lot of different gothic novels, either the original characters or then people who are related to the original characters. So the main group in this series are the daughters of Jekyll and Hyde, Rappaccini's daughter, the basically Bride of Frankenstein, and a girl who was made from a puma by Dr. Moreau. I did like the first book more than the second one, which was a surprise to me because I was expecting to love this, because this one brings into the mix a lot of different vampire classics. So I was really expecting to love this, but the middle part was a bit of a slog. I think this book was just a bit too long. The ebook was about 700 pages. One thing that I really like about this series is how it makes me read some horror classics that I either have missed or I just haven't read yet. In preparation for the first book, I read Rappaccini's Daughter by Nathaniel Hawthorne, because Rappaccini was the only name that I didn't recognize from the back of the book. So after the second book, I will pick up She by H. Rider Haggard, which I hadn't heard of before, and also another horror classic in preparation for the third one that I'm not going to mention because spoilers, but that I have been meaning to read. I gave this book 3 stars. Next I read Thorn by Intisar, which was an Overdrive ebook my hold from the library came in, and it is a young adult retelling of the Goose Girl fairy tale. So Princess Allura is traveling from her cruel family to be the bride of a prince of a neighboring country. Since this is the Goose Girl fairy tale, something happens on the way, she's betrayed, and she ends up living as a goose girl when they arrive. Now she has to choose whether she wants to continue living as the goose girl, have this simple life that she's been craving for, or try to take back her place in order to save the kingdom. I really liked reading this Goose Girl retelling. It's been a while since I read a fairy tale retelling, and I do really love them. I sometimes forget, but after I picked this up, I just couldn't put it down. I like the descriptions of the everyday life of Goose Girl as much as I like the threat of the Fae Sorceress with an intergenerational grudge. This book takes a look at abuse and how the law works differently for different social classes. So when living as a Goose Girl, Allura learns about the injustices that the common people face. I have to say that the story got surprisingly dark at about the halfway point, so take that as a warning. Content warnings for this book for sibling domestic abuse, rape, and if you're familiar with the Goose Girl fairy tale, you know animal death is coming. I was expecting a little more from the ending, but I had a good time and I would just easily get sucked into reading this for a long amount of time. I gave this 4 stars. So since I had such a good time with a fairy tale retelling, I decided to pick up another one that I've been meaning to read for a while, and that one is Peter Darling by Austin Chant. It was another ebook from the library, so this is a novella and it is a Peter Pan retelling with a romance with Captain Hook. And along with Thorn, this was my favorite read in May. So this is about Peter Pan returning to Neverland as a young man. In this retelling, Peter Pan is a trans man and he originally left Neverland because he wanted to go home back to his family and grow up. Because he thought he could resign himself to life in the Darling family according to their gender expectations. But he realizes he cannot do it. It is all wrong for him. His family won't accept him and he goes back. And the majority of this book is actually set in Neverland and there are flashbacks, some flashbacks to our world. So in the original Peter Pan story, I really love the juxtaposition between childhood dreams and childhood cruelty. How these children have these fantasy adventures while they're also playing war games. And this novella really takes a look at that bloody side of Neverland and how things have changed in Peter's absence and also how Peter's presence changes the stories in Neverland. So that was cool, how Neverland changes according to the stories and wishes of the people who go there. Like I said, there is a romance with Captain James Hook and I really like the conversations that he and Peter had, you know, after they stopped trying to kill each other. They were really into fighting each other. But when the story had them work together, when they were alone together, it was so fascinating to see them learn how to talk to each other. This is currently out of print, but when it comes available, I recommend it if you are into fairy tale retellings and romance with sword fights. I gave Peter Darling 4 stars. Next I read The Tropic of Serpents by Mary Brennan, which is an old physical book, and it's a fantasy of manners. It's the second book in a series. And this one was in my You Choose What I Read poll in May, and it got last place, but I read it anyway. I did start reading the book that won that poll, so that one was The Light Read by Frances Hardinge, but that one took me longer to read. So in the second book in the Memoir by Lady Trent series, we see our protagonist travel to another continent to study the swamp worm. Of course, there are political machinations going on in the country that she travels to that Isabella, the Lady Trent, can't ignore, however much she would just like to study dragons. Most of the book is set in the swamps, with Isabella learning the way of the people who live there who have a link to dragons. And like in the first book, she and her entourage sometimes make a mess of things and not always understanding the locals. I'm always much more interested in the dragon stuff and the cultural stuff than in the wider politics in the series. Near the end, the book was like, many of you are no doubt anxious to leave the dusty byways of natural history and get back to the, you know, the current threat the nation was facing. And I was like, no, I'm here for the natural history. Let me know more about the dragons. I really like the writing style of these books. I think the way it's written with like older Lady Trent writing her memoirs works really well, and I gave this book 4 stars. Reading The Tropic of Serpents put my TBR down to 68 books. Next I read another owned physical book, and that one was The Mysterious Benedict Society by Trenton Lee Stewart, and this is a middle grade mystery spy adventure, and I buddy read this with Rachel from Khanani. So in this one, a group of kids respond to this newspaper ad that is looking for gifted children to take part in a test to go on a secret mission, and our protagonists are 4 children who either don't have or have run away from their families, and they are the 4 that of course succeed in the tests, and they are sent undercover to fulfill this weird mission involving a society that mind controls people. I like the beginning with the tests the best. It was fun to try to see what the organizers were looking for with each challenge. And my favorite character was actually this adult side character that I really enjoyed, even though she didn't feature much in the book. So she was like there when they were holding these challenges. I wasn't a super big fan of where this book went. I didn't find the villain's plot that interesting, and the ending had some things left open and then some things wrapped up too neatly, mainly regarding the kids' parents and stuff, but it was still a fun read and I enjoyed talking about this with Rachel. One thing we noticed was that my edition was localized, so I read the UK edition. This is originally a book from the US and some locations had been changed and stuff like that. I gave this book 3 stars. It was still a fun read, and reading this put my TBR count to 67 books. Next, I read a couple of comics that I didn't really enjoy. I read Die Volume 2, Split the Party by Kieron, Gillen and Stephanie Hans, and I read this from the library, and it is a fantasy comic. So in this, there's a group of friends who as teens played this tabletop RPG and got sucked into this fantasy world, are drawn back in again to that world as adults. I checked out the second volume to see if I cared about it more than the first, but I didn't. I just didn't care for any of the characters. This is just not for me. I was hoping that it was because I like Kieron Gillen as a writer, but I just can't get sucked into this story. Also, while the painterly art can be sometimes quite striking, it doesn't always draw your eyes to where you are supposed to be looking. The coloring is sometimes a little muddy, and at times I had to go back and go like, oh, so that was what that panel was trying to show me. So since I don't care about what happens to these people, I let the series be. I gave this one 2 stars. The next comic I read was Southern Cross Volume 2, Romulus by Becky Cloonan and Andy Belanger, and I read this from the library, and it was a science fiction horror comic. I talked about the first volume in my previous reads and receipts. That one was more of a cosmic horror murder mystery, whereas this one is like crooked companies, strange politics between the workers and the management of this one methane rig. So this one was not as good as the first one. I didn't find the setting interesting, nor did I find the plot that interesting. The thing that I liked was that the main character was Hazel, and she was this old woman who was an ex-detective, current personal assistant, and she was badass. And I'm all for like badass old ladies. Also, where the first volume worked on its own, the second one didn't really have an ending, and so far the series hasn't been continued. And even if it is continued, I don't think I will continue on with it. So if you're looking for some space horror, I would probably just read the first volume, since that works on its own. I gave this one 2 stars as well. I also took part in a couple of readathons in May. I took part in Asian Readathon, which was hosted by Read with Cindy, and I read a couple of books for that. I read Revenge by Yōko, Ogawa, which I got from the library, and it's a collection of these darker short stories. This collection has 11 short stories, so quite a few, and they are these sort of slice of life stories with weird or dark elements dropped in. Most of them are interlinked, but in like really small ways, like there's a location or a character mentioned in one that is elaborated more in another. Some of them are more linked than others. And finally, I don't have a lot to say about this. Perhaps because it's been a while and I didn't write anything down about these stories when I was reading it, or perhaps these stories just didn't stick in my mind. I don't remember having a particular favorite story in the collection, for example. There wasn't anything wrong as such in the stories or with the writing. In fact, I did read like one or two of these a day, and I liked the atmosphere that they wrapped me in while I was reading, but they didn't have that big of an impact on me after I put the book down. So I think 3 stars maybe? Then I read The Perilous Life of Jade Yeo by Zen Cho, and this is an owned ebook that I have. It's available for free, I will link it down below, and it is a historical romance novella. This is set in 1920s London, and the main character is Jade Yeo, who is a writer, and she starts an affair with this writer whose book she wrote a scathing review of. And I'm pretty torn about this book, because Cho's writing is so likeable. This is told in the form of the main character's journal, and Jade's writing is marvelously like tongue-in-cheek. But then again, this novella features a trope or plot point that I dislike in romance novels, or I think pretty much anywhere. If you want to see what the trope is, I will link my Goodreads review down below. I have it there in spoiler tags. So yes, I'm a bit torn, but I'd still say this was an enjoyable reading experience. Zen Cho just brings this whimsical, likable flair to her stories that I tend to fall for, and I gave this one 3.5 stars. Then I read a contemporary manga that I borrowed from Reya from the Book Finch, and that one was Silver Spoon Volume 1 by Hiromu Arakawa. So this tells about this boy who burned out in his studies and doesn't know what to do with his life, so he enrolls into an agricultural high school far away from his hometown. Arakawa has a deft hand in characterization and storytelling, but I just wasn't that interested in the subject matter. So this manga does educate readers about farming practices and such, and sometimes it goes to like textbooky levels. That's a bit too much. And there's content warning for fat shaming, even though the character is confident there are others who make jokes about her. I gave this one 2.5 stars. Then was the weekend-long Torathon hosted by Libby Stevenson, and I read a couple of short stories for this. First, I read These Deathless Bones by Cassandra Kaur, which is a Tor.com short story. I will link it below. It's available for free. And this is a horror story with a fairy tale-ish feel about the second wife of a king and the discord between her and her young stepson. I found out when I was reading this that I had already read it at some point, so that tells me something about how it sticks into my mind, and that I wasn't maybe super into it if I can't remember it at all. But I have to say that it had some cool moments. I have read the novella Hammers on Bone from Kaur before, and I wasn't super into that either. So I think it's just Kaur's writing style generally that doesn't tend to work for me. I will still pick up and try out something else from her if she comes up, if she comes out with something with the subject matter that I find interesting. I don't know, 2.5? Next I read A Dead Gin in Cairo by P. Jelly Clark, and this is also a short story that is available online, I will link it below. Set in 1912 in alternate Cairo that has things like jinn and ghouls and angels about, this tells about a special investigator in the Ministry of Alchemy who investigates a suicide case that turns out to have a bigger plot behind it. I like the world and I like these angels with these mechanical bodies, and I read this because I want to read the novella The Haunting of Tramcar 015, which is set in the same world. This short story definitely made me curious about the world and I want to learn more. I gave this 3 stars. Then my final read was a Tour.com novella that I didn't finish during the Tourathon, but I started it then, and it also fits for the Asian Readathon, and that one was The Empress of Salt and Fortune by Nivo. So this is an owned ebook, and it's a fantasy novella that the marketing likened to a classic Asian period drama. This tells the story of a royal from a country in the north who is sent to a country in the south for a political marriage to become empress. So it chronicles her story, but the way the story is told is really interesting because it is told by her former handmaiden who is telling the story to this cleric, while the cleric chronicles the contents of this house where the empress used to live. I found the storytelling through objects that spark memories to be really beautiful, and I liked how we got this calm story about studying and preserving the past, along with the story of big political upheaval. The cleric uses they-them pronouns and also has this talking bird as a companion or assistant. The bird is called Almost Brilliant. I actually think that I read this in 2 short snippets because I always was reading this right before I fell asleep during multiple nights, so I think I might like this even more if I read it again, and I gave this one 3.5 stars. There's a sequel coming out, so I think I will reread this before I pick up the sequel. So now we're moving on to the receipts. Did I make progress in my 10 books that I want to read in 2020 list? And yes, I read 2 books from that finally. I read The Tropic of Serpents by Mary Brennan and European Travel for Monstrous Gentlewoman by Theodora Goss. So these are the first 2 that I read, so I still have 8 left from that list. Did I read a book for my reread challenge? No. But I did read a book for my TBR chart challenge. I had 2 challenges and I completed the read the book with the longest title challenge with the Mysterious Benedict Society. Since this is a recap video, I won't pick another challenge just now. I will pick it when I get to my most recent reads and receipts. I still have 1 challenge left, and that is to read a book featured in a book haul revisit video. I've had that one for a while. As to a haul, I did buy some ebooks in May and I will link my spring book haul where I talk about them. But I forgot to mention one ebook, and that one was The Candlevine Gardener and Other Stories by Yoon Ha Lee, which is a collection of flash fairy tales gathered from the last few years of his Patreon, and he made it available for free, and I will link it below if it's still there. And now for the stats, which are the highest of the year. You might remember that I did the video Can I Read All These Books? A Friday Reads video in late May, where I showed you a stack of books and comics that I wanted to finish during the final week. And I did finish all of them except for the light read. So I read 14 books, that was 3,410 pages. On average, I read 110 pages a day, but on average, I took 15 days for a book. And that is because I finished a couple of books that I had been reading since March. And my current physical TBR number is 67 books. Let's hope that I can keep it under 70. So that's all that I read in May, and I'm slowly catching up with my reads and receipts and maybe making some headway in my TBR pile. But that's all from me for now, and I will see you in my next video.